I'm going to ask you to go ahead and open your Bibles to Genesis chapter number 37, and I'm going to get right into the word this morning, and I'm going to ask you to participate today in many ways. One way is to say amen, or right on, or oh me, or talk about it, or something like that while I'm preaching, because I'm insecure. So I need, you know, I have these inferiority complexes I deal with. So I need your encouragement. That's number one. Then number two, I need you to participate in regards to your time today. This is our first Sunday together as a church, me being here. So I'm going to ask you to be so kind and so considerate that you would give me two services today. Here is why. This first message I'm going to preach pertains to this house. Oh, it will touch everybody that listens, of course. But as I prayed about it, God gave me pinpoint precision with this first message concerning Place for Life and its pastors. So that's good. The second service, I'm going to talk about a prophetic word for 2017 that has to do with the universal church, or what we refer to as the body of Christ. So there'll be, you know, this very unique, conspicuous, concentrated word in this service, and then a more general, applicable word to the body of Christ in the second service. Therefore, turn to three people and tell them, we need you to be in attendance today. It's okay to give God one Sunday, right? Genesis chapter 37. I want to encourage my platform guests today that if you're going to sit on the platform while I preach, do not text. Because I'll call you out. So I love all y'all, but if you're on your phone, you better be taking notes. Because I'll be checking your phone in a minute. Because a lot of people use their phone to take notes with. Yeah. And I do that periodically, but usually if you see me on my phone, I'm either texting or on Facebook. Why, Bishop? To see what everybody's doing. Y'all are in such a great mood today. I'm so happy that we all are here. Amen. I really love you, and I'm glad to be home today. I think it was last Sunday I wasn't here. Is that right? So it's good to be home on this particular Sunday. And thank you, Pastor Dustin, for this opening. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. You asked me to do this, and I'm thrilled to do it. Genesis 37, verse number 1. And Jacob dwelt in the land wherein his father was a stranger. That by itself will preach. In the land of Canaan. These are the generations of Jacob. Joseph, being 17 years old, was feeding the flock with his brothers. How old was he? 17 years old. And he was feeding the flock with his brothers. And the lad was with the sons of Bilhah and the sons of Zilpah, his father's wives. And Joseph brought unto his father their evil report. Now Israel loved Joseph more than all his children, because he was the son of his old age. And he made him a coat of many colors. And when his brothers saw that their father loved him more than all his brothers, they hated him and could not speak peaceably unto him. I'm going to preach a message this morning entitled The Joy of Being Joseph. Just say those words to a few folks around you. The joy of being Joseph. And Father, we now thank you for this scripture, these four verses of Scripture. And I ask you to enlighten the eyes of our understanding today and help these people to participate in a word that will literally change their life in every regard, in perspective, in perception, and even in paradigm. Their lives will be changed. The way they see things, why they see things, the way they see them, and how they look at them. We thank you, God, that our future now looks much better than our past. And we give you praise that we stand in the transition of leaving where we have been and now peering into a prophetic day that looks ever brighter by the moment. And we give you praise now for every utterance that will go forth from this pulpit. And we thank you, Lord God, that the word of God is like a hammer that breaks to pieces. The heart of stone is like a sword that divides soul and spirit. Have your way today. In Jesus' name, I break every generational curse. Dismiss every generational spirit. Anything that has lined itself up against our lineage, anything diametrically opposed to our destiny, is now rebuked in the name of Jesus. Just reach over and gently touch somebody and tell them everything is all right. We are like this all the time. Don't be scared. This is who we are. You know, I thank God that I go to church with people that's been through a lot. I really do. I thank God that I go to a church. I know a lot of you folks. You know, and I've watched you. Many of you have absolutely no reason to be in this house today, but you love God so much you can't help yourself. Well, high five three people one more time and tell them it's on right now. Amen. And then you may be seated. And Joseph, being 17 years old, 2017. As I studied this year in prophetic perspective, there are so many things that stood out to me that I could not find one thing to be discouraged about. I kept digging around in it for about a month and a week, about 5 weeks, trying to find something that was contradictory to the victory I was feeling in my spirit. I just couldn't find it. I kept looking, I couldn't find it. Then every time I'd lift my spiritual eyes and look at the, you know, what's going on around us in our nation, I thought, well, certainly that opposes what I feel in the spirit. And I could hear God say, that's the way it's supposed to be. And God began to show me that he's going to do something supernaturally in and through his people. As I begin to study this number, I learned that there were 17 nations that were represented at Pentecost. Found that to be interesting. There are 17 judges from the death of Joshua until Samuel was anointed to be a priest, prophet, and judge. There are 17 of them. The Ten Commandments of God were given in 17 verses in the 20th chapter of the book of Exodus. I learned that Jehu, you know, that guy that was pulled apart to be anointed, that he reigned as king for 17 years. I learned that in John chapter 21, verse 11, that Peter drew up the net to land, and it was full of great fish, and in that net there were exactly 153 fish. If you add 1 plus 2 plus 3 plus 4 plus 5 plus 6 plus 7 plus 8 plus 9 plus 10 plus 11 plus 12 plus 13 plus 14 plus 15 plus 16 plus 17, you come up with 153. Different kinds of fish. The Lord began to speak to me that this would be a year steeped in diversity and integration, where our distinctions now would be appreciated and not depreciate it. But we'll talk about that at a later date in the book of 1 Corinthians, the 13th chapter, the 17th mention of the word love comes from the Apostle Paul when he says love is the greatest gift of all. 17 is all in Scripture. I don't have time to go through them, but I found one to be very interesting, one fact in Scripture, Pastor Dustin, that the word land is mentioned 1,717 times. 1,717 times in the Bible. The most important thing, and you know we always look for a word, and I'll go through the rest of this in the next service, but we always look for a word that we would say the word for the year of 2017 is, and then we state and declare that. Well, first of all, you have to look at this combination of perfect numbers. 7 and 10 both are perfect in all through Scripture. 10 is the number of spiritual order. 7 is the number of spiritual perfection. So you would look at 17 as a number of perfect spiritual order, where God brings everything perfectly together in order. Order is not the opposite of disorder. Order is the opposite of entropy. We'll talk about that word at a later date. So you must understand how significant the year is. Now, you say, Bishop, is it really that important that we concentrate on the number 17 as we embark on the year of 2017? Well, not necessarily, not for all of us, because if you're not interested, you're certainly not going to receive anything. Now, God, he is a God that's interested in numbers. I mean, Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus. What's the next book of the Bible? Numbers comes just before Deuteronomy, which means repetition or rehearsal, to repeat what you learned in Numbers. So numbers are significant to God. I encourage you to study the day you're born, the hour you were born, the month you were born, the year you were born. Add them together. Find the good in the numbers that have to do with you. That's how much I believe in the power of numbers. Now, after today, you will not look at numbers the same again. Some of you are already adding up your birthday. Try to find out what it comes to, you know, what it adds up to. Somehow try to figure out what it means to you. You'll be surprised. But let me tell you, there's good in all numbers. Now, let me say that again. There is good in all numbers. God is good. Even the number 13, the number 11, even though it is a revolt, 11 is also a revolution. So 13, everybody looks at 13 as the unlucky number. 13 is the addition of one to the government, which is 12. Are y'all with me so far? Some of y'all do not care. But it's okay, because those of us who are interested will get something out of this. Now, let me bring this home to Place for Life now. 2017 will be very unique to this church. I have prayed for you late into the hour last night. As a matter of fact, I went to sleep about 12 something, and I woke up at 3, and I've been up since 3. It's been like that the last few nights because I've been praying for you. The Lord showed me something about this church, that anyone that connects themselves to this house is going to have a very blessed year in 2017. The Lord said, you know, in my prayer time, that the timing is right. You know, timing is ever so significant. So if I was going to sum up 2017 for Place for Life, I would say this is going to be the year of your favor. This is going to be the year of your favor. And I'm going to talk about this some in the next service, but it's also going to be your year of overcoming. Now, not just victory. And in the next service, I'm going to talk to you about the difference in victory and overcoming. Y'all liking it so far? You ought to. But our text says Joseph was 17 years old. And what was he doing? The Bible says, Pastor Dustin, that he was feeding. You can just stop there. At 17, he was feeding. People that walk in favor and know they have favor have no problem feeding other people. Because you know you have an abundance of supply. So you don't mind sharing. Stingy people always are insecure in regards to favor. Because they're afraid to do a favor for somebody else makes them lose the favor that they're walking in. And they do not know that the favor you do for someone else is the favor that is increasing on your life. Touch your neighbor and tell them, feed favor, baby. Just feed favor. In other words, you feed favor by speaking of favor. You repeat favor. You rehearse favor. But in order to rehearse favor, you have to walk like you have favor. It's a shame to have favor and other people not be able to see it. So it is your responsibility to display favor, to demonstrate favor. It is your responsibility to distribute favor. God does not give you favor for you to be selfish with it. Tell somebody, feed favor. Yeah, feed everybody favor. Amen. If God's been good to you, he's been good to you so you can be good to somebody else. Now, he's feeding his flock because it's his responsibility. This is a day and this is a year you must pay close attention to what God has assigned you to. What I just told you is cut off the frivolity. Did you hear what I said? Cut it off. Quit playing around with the call of God on your life. Quit acting like you don't have a specific assignment, like you are not some unique individual that God created as a prototype and there's nobody else like you. Quit acting like you everybody else and start acting like you somebody else. Y'all not talking back to me like I'm talking to you. Amen. So it's very important that you walk in the favor that God has bestowed upon you. Walk in the distinction, the distribution. Oh, God is good. So he's feeding the flock, which means he's taking care of his personal responsibility. This is what his father told him to do. He told him to do one thing. He said, go and feed the flock. That's it. He didn't tell him to do anything else. Now, Joseph, you got one thing to do. Feed. That's it. That's all you have to do. And I hear God saying to his people in 2017, quit doing everything. And do the one thing that I've told you to do. When you're trying to serve every tributary, then you lose the current God has given you to become a river. Some of us are trickling trying to make a difference. When God is trying to call you to be a current, you can't be a current with force while you're giving stuff everywhere trying to be everything to everybody. Be who God called you to be. Touch your neighbor and tell him, feed the flock. And so he's doing the one thing. The father Jacob said, Joseph, do one thing, feed this flock. Woo! What did the Lord tell Peter? After Peter denied him, he said, do you love me? He said, yes, Lord, you know I love you. He told him three times. Then feed the flock. He failed him. But in his restoration, Jesus did not say, you've got to go through 12 steps of recuperating everything you lost. He didn't even mention anything he lost. He said, just get back to doing what you know you're supposed to be doing, which is feed the flock. Prove your love by serving your purpose. Focus your energy on doing what God has called you to do. You ought to lift your hands now and let me prophesy to you and tell you it is time for you to pick your call back up, to get back in your purpose. Quit playing around with God, giving yourself to everything and everybody trying to find satisfaction. When you know the only fulfillment that you'll ever find in your life is when you are establishing the perfect will of God that he has called and assigned to you as an individual. You don't have time to be going everywhere doing everything. Be what God called you to do and feed the flock. Now, I need you to look at no less than four people and tell them, feed them with favor, baby. Feed them with favor. I'm sorry. I'm trying to hurry up. I'm going to skip some of this here. So, place for life, I came by to tell you to get back to doing the one thing that God has called you to do. And if you're going to feed the flock, then you must understand the flock. To understand the flock, you have to be part of the flock. People who are part of the flock do not flip-flop around. People who are part of the flock are not fickle in the face of adversity. People who are part of the flock know the power of emergent behavior, which is spontaneous order. When you're part of the flock and the flock starts moving, you move with the flock. You're not always finding a reason to oppose and resist and question and bring up your opinion. No, you just say the flock is moving that way and it is my responsibility to flow with the flock. I need you to tell four people, flow with the flock. The word flock means a unit of people that follow a leader. Specifically, it means a congregation that follow the lead of its pastor. Read it. Read what Daniel Webster had to say about it. It's powerful. It's a church. Amen. And all through Scripture, the Bible calls us the sheep of his pasture. No, you're not a goat. No, you're not an elephant. No, you're not a donkey or a horse. You are a lamb. That's what God called you. We are the sheep of his pasture. So then we need to study sheep and find out how sheep flow and find out how sheep operate. Whew. And when one sheep goes away, the shepherd goes, gets one sheep, carries him back on his shoulders. Talk to me. So feed the flock. That means we ought to be feeding each other. Oh my God, here today. It's time for us to get focused back on the congregation we belong to. Stop taking away from each other and start giving to each other. In other words, you're feeding each other. When you walk in here and you know a brother has been struggling all week, now you wouldn't know that if you were not in relationship with him. And it's time for you to, some of you to come out of your cubicle and get into the house. Be concerned about a brother. Be concerned about a sister. Quit finding fault and start following the flow. And feed your brother and feed your sister with encouragement, exhortation. Quit gossiping about the man across the sanctuary from you. Leave him alone. If you can't say anything good, then don't say anything at all. Feed each other encouragement. Feed the flock. Oh, my God, today, this church, somebody ought to clap your hands and praise him. I'm sorry, y'all. Because when you're in your flock, you are among your people. Which means you've learned their cadence. You've learned their call. Woo! I don't know about people that bounce around from church to church, how you can recognize voices. Because every church is its own tribe. Yes, Pastor Rick, we are part of the universal body of Jesus Christ. But he also sets every member in particular. You can't be a hand here and a foot over there. So you have found your flock when you have learned to function properly in the family. Bishop, you're preaching so good, this is ridiculous. You shouldn't be preaching this good. I sound like Morris Cirillo. Some of y'all know him, Mike knows him very well. He always talks in the third person. Brother Cirillo says, like it's not him. And sometimes I do that when I'm preaching. Bishop says. I want you to say it one more time. Feed the flock. Feed the flock. Amen. Quit taking from your brothers and sisters. Quit finding fault with your brothers and sisters. Now let's bring it down more succinctly. I've got 10 minutes here. And I'll be done. So what is he doing? Tell me, what is he doing? Thank you, Pastor D. Thank you. The second thing the Lord showed me in this passage of Scripture was who he was with while he was feeding the flock. Now, you say he was with his brothers, and I say, you're right. But let's say, look at it a little bit closer. Because really, he was with his half-brothers. In other words, we got some of the same blood, but we don't have all the same blood. Everybody. Everybody got their mama and their daddy living in them. Hang out with them long enough and you'll see both of them at one point or another. Well, here he is tending the flock or feeding the flock with half brothers. Be careful when you're feeding with half people. They half in, half out. Half committed, half not. Half faithful, half not faithful. Half loyal, half not loyal. Half blooded. They want the blood of Jesus on Sunday, but they don't want it on Monday. Want it on Wednesday, but not on Thursday. Half blooded. And the Bible says that these half brothers were born of two different women, one Bilhah and one Zilpah. And Bilhah literally means faltering. It means one that causes others to lose strength that results in losing momentum. And then Zilpah means frailty or to droop, to hang down, to be bent over. It's a picture of fatigue. So you got one that's faltering, one that's frail. So you got two half-brothers, one half group of brothers. They are born of a woman whose name means I'm losing strength, which ultimately means I lose momentum. You lose momentum when you stop appreciating moments. They lived in the same house. Y'all not hearing me. They lived in the same house as Joseph, hearing the same words from the same father. Now let me tell you something. When brothers start acting certain ways, the father takes note of attitude. And he will begin to adjust his attention based on the attitude that you are exhibiting. God loves you all the time and he's patient with you to change. But God can't use people with a bad attitude. I can prove that to you in the book of Philippians. Let this attitude be in you that was found in Christ, who humbled himself. There's only one attitude to follow, which means you can't be looking out for yourself all the time. And it's obvious that both sets of half-brothers had one thing in their mind, and that was their self. My God, here today. So the other sister means, Zilpah means drooping or hanging down to bend over, a picture of fatigue. And the Lord told me to tell you, be careful who you appoint to feed the flock with you. Check their momentum status. Check their fatigue status. Check their frailty. Frailty means easily offended. To be frail is to be too sensitive. Y'all not helping me. Be careful who you pull up alongside of you, Pastor Dustin, in 2017. If they not moving and catching momentum, don't try to pull them, baby. If they not pushing you, you don't want them. Is that too hard, Dory? It's high time for pastors to stop pulling people. Come on, you can do it, you can do it, you can do it, you can do it, you can do it. No, you need to be behind your leader saying, let's do this thing. I dare you to touch somebody and tell them, get the momentum. Momentum is a powerful thing when you have it, and it's a horrible thing when you don't. Because once you lose it, it's almost impossible to get it back. And the only way to get it back is to insert an agent into the matter that already has it in him that he can impart it to the people connected to him who lost it in a previous stage of life. In other words, what I said is somebody among us got to be on fire. Somebody among us has got to be full of zeal. Somebody somebody among us has got to want it more than anything. Don't make nobody pull you and quit being so sensitive. Lift up your hands if you're weak. Stand up straight if you've been bent over. It's time for you to get your faith back. It's time for you to get your forward motion back. It's time for you to take off the cloak of heaviness and oppression and depression. Get it off of you. Wake up and realize stuff happens in life. Get over it and get your momentum back. It don't take but a moment. I dare you to look at four people and tell them it don't take but a moment. It don't take but one service. It don't take but one touch. It don't take but one word. It don't take but one move. God wants to shift you from a mundane life to a life filled with momentum. Momentum has a way of carrying you. And I hear the Holy Ghost say 2017 will be a shift of momentum. When you are in competition, momentum decides the win. Momentum decides the victory. Whoever gets the momentum changes the game. You can be losing for three quarters and enter the fourth quarter and catch one little mystery called momentum and sprint to the end of the game and receive the trophy because something shifted. Oh, if you'll lift your hand, begin to pray, I believe God will baptize you with fire. See, fire brings momentum, zeal, vehemence, excitement, enthusiasm. I'm going to give you about 30 seconds to get all excited about God changing your game. Now here's the key. You can stay standing. Here's the key. In the same way that momentum is contagious, depression is contagious. Some of you are wondering, why do I feel depressed so much lately? It ain't you. It's the people who've been talking to you. Hanging down, drooping, down in the mouth. Discouraged. I don't know how we're going to do it. I can't believe this happened to my family. I can't believe my kids are acting like this. I can't believe, oh my goodness, I don't know what we're going to do. My God, pray for them. Hang with them. Encourage them. And give them a time. And you decide. I'm going to give you about 2 months. Get your shoulders back square, your head back up. Because I'm not going to let you be a continual drain on my momentum. Some people you talk to, everything they say is all, everything is about what's wrong. Y'all stay standing, I'm done. What was he doing? Help us, Jesus. What was he doing? Who was he with? We got some of the same blood, but we don't have all the same blood. Why do you think when Joseph finally found a full-blooded brother, he couldn't help but weep? He pulled him aside from everybody, laid his head on his shoulders and began to cry because he finally found someone who he could connect with. Why do you think Joseph gave all of his brothers one portion, but when it came to Benjamin, he gave him 5 times more than the other brothers? Because he found a full-blooded brother, and he fed him with favor. When you find full-blooded people, feed them with favor. Now I want you to hug three people around you because we family in here. Go ahead, hug them, hug them. Three people around you, just give them a little embrace. What are you doing? You're feeding them right now. Man, I am over time. I'm sorry, Pastor Dustin. I don't have time to preach the last point. Stay standing, I'll just tell you. What was he doing? Who was he with? Last point was, and I don't have time to preach it, what he was wearing. We call it a coat of many colors, but we know that it was the coat of favor. Now, the coat he wore, Pastor Dustin, he didn't ask for. Quit showing everything you beg God for to everybody. I pleaded with God for this. I finally got it. And look, and you act like that's your testimony. No, your testimony is when you wear stuff you didn't ask for. In other words, I didn't even have to pray about this. The Father just walked in my room and just threw it on me. Are y'all in this building? Show everybody. Let everybody know, my daddy gave me this. I didn't pray about it. I didn't ask him for it. I just woke up and realized, man, I got favor all over me. This is your year. Place for life. Lift your hands, Pastor Dustin, Joanna, who's home with the newborn. As the overseer of this house, I prophesy to you that this is a year of great favor for you, 2017. You know, I was thinking about you in prayer this morning, and 17 was a very strange year for you. I recall specific events that I refused to rehearse in front of the public. But 17 was a challenging year for you because you begin to feel the call of God. But you also was dealing with being an adolescent, and you were right in the middle of enjoying an adolescent life. But God haunted you. At times he taunted you because he was not going to leave you alone until you said, okay, Father, I take the coat. You were 17. Listen to your pops. You're twice that age now. You're twice that age and one. God brought you all the way full circle back to now you're walking in what you dreamed of. And this year is a year of realization. You don't have to prove anything. Number one. Number two, be careful, very careful about half-blooded brothers. Be very careful about people that pull up next to you that don't have momentum in mind. Be very careful with spending too much time with people who are always down. Surround yourself with celebratory people, revelatory people. Help everybody, but don't give a lot of virtue to stuff that refuses to change. You can't heal what don't want to be healed. You can't fix what is decided to be broken. That's number two. Number three, get ready for God to give you so much provision that you can even give your haters one portion. But those that love you, get ready to be able to give them five portions. This is the year for Place for Life. Now I want this church to go berserk with excitement and enthusiasm.
what God is about. Come on, just lean on somebody and rub your favor on them. Rub your favor off on somebody.
Your favor. Your favor. We receive favor. Oh, we say your favor. Your favor. We receive favor.
Come on, let those hands and say it.
I want you to do. You're going to learn something in this next message, Pastor Dustin. You know, I've been talking a lot on Facebook and Twitter and Instagram about this word I have. Well, this wasn't it. This was for this house. This next word in this next service is the one that I have been working on. Here's what you're going to learn. What you say is very important. We already know that. So let's practice. I want you to look at a few people and say these words to them. You're going to speak to them. Okay? You're not going to say, I am. You're going to say, you are, which means you're helping them adjust. Okay? So what you're going to say is, you are not frail. Go ahead. Tell a few folks, you are not frail. Erica, Yolanda, Ken, you are not frail, Josh. You ready? Second thing. Look at them and say these words. You are not faulty. Get it out of your mind. Come on, tell them, do not expect fault. Do not look for fault. You are not a faulty individual. Now look at them one more time and tell them, I got one more thing to say to you. That's what you're not. But this is what you are. You are blessed. Are you ready? And holly, 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 holly. Favorite, 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 favorite. Tell them you got so much favor on you, it's ridiculous.